Now go on to part B. Remember, you are not allowed to take any notes or write in your test book. To simulate the CBT, do not read the answer choices while you listen to the recording. Do not read ahead, and do not return to a question once you have answered it. Question 16 to 18. Listen to two students talking about their involvement with music.
What are you doing after class? Do you want to go for a cup of coffee?
Coffee sounds great, but I have to go to orchestra practice from 5 to 7 p.m.
Really? I didn't know you were a musician.
Well, I'm not a professional musician. I'm just an amateur. I play the violin in the university orchestra.
When did you start playing?
When I was 7. My elementary school had an orchestra program, and I always enjoyed playing the violin.
That's great. I wish I hadn't given up on the piano when I was young.
It takes dedication, but it's never too late to learn.
Number 16. What does the woman want to do after class? Number 17. How long has the man been playing the violin? Number 18. According to the discussion, what does the woman wish she had done? Questions 19 to 22. Listen to part of a class discussion in an environmental studies class. The professor is focusing on a controversy between economics and ecology. Up to now in this class, we've had a basic introduction to some of the issues in environmental studies, but we haven't yet examined the controversies that abound in this field. So today, we'll look at one of those. It centers on issues in economics as well as in ecology. Both of these words, in fact, stem from the same root word. Does anyone know what the Greek root word echo means?
I think it means house.
That's correct. So one might think that the two words, economy and ecology, wouldn't be in conflict. Yet in many people's minds, they represent conflicting views on how to approach our environment, both in terms of current needs and in terms of planning for the future. People coming from an ecological perspective have been widely labeled as the enemy of economic progress. And people who are concerned with progress are often seen as anti-environmental. Actually, this is not a new conflict. The first clash between economic advancement and preservation of the natural environment probably occurred thousands of years ago. Since humans first began to develop land for agriculture and permanent settlements, plants and animals and their natural ecological cycles have been affected. Of course, development at that time was on a small enough scale that its overall effect on the environment was minimal. But over time, with a massive increase in human population and the widespread use of advanced technology, we have seen a startling rise in the number of plant and animal species that have become extinct or are seriously endangered. Scientists say that in one day alone, about 45 plant and animal species die out. And it is this issue, development versus environmental protection, that is the basis of the clash.
Well, I don't know how this can be solved, but is there a way to stop the mass extinction of plants and animals?
Well, yes, at least to some extent. Conservation measures are being taken by some governments around the world. Years ago, the U.S. government established the Endangered Species Act to protect plant and animal species that are in danger of extinction. This act has already helped save a number of species. For example, the blue whale, the bald eagle, and the peregrine falcon. It has also stopped or altered some land development that might endanger the environment.
If we stop land development in order to protect plants and animals, how will we take care of the needs of a growing population?
You've put your finger right on the issue here. As we examine economic and ecological issues, we must consider who will benefit and who will suffer from our actions. This is a difficult social and political issue as well, one that often divides factions both within a country and internationally. For instance, there is international concern about the destruction of the rainforest, but economic issues in rainforest areas must be considered. One example is the issue of how to allocate funds. Even though a government may want to spend money on protecting the environment, they may have more pressing needs, such as providing for people in dire need of food and clothing. So the issue is complex. It's not a simple debate, and there are no easy solutions. Number 19. What is the major issue that the professor is discussing? Number 20. What does the Greek root word echo mean? Number 21. According to the professor, what has been the result of an increasing human population? Number 22. What is the main objective of the U.S. government's Endangered Species Act? Questions 23 to 26. Listen to two students talking about registering for classes.
What a nightmare! I've been trying to register for classes all day, but a number of the classes I want are already full.
I bet that plenty of other students are in the same boat.
Possibly. But I need to take these classes now if I'm going to graduate in June.
I had the same dilemma when I was an undergraduate. But I had a fairly effective way of getting around the problem.
Really? What did you do? I'm open to ideas.
Well, if a class was full, but I really needed it, I'd go to the first class meeting and sit in. Then I'd explain the situation to the professor and ask if I could audit the class if no space opened up for me to join officially.
But you don't get credit or a grade when you audit a class.
That's true, but 95% of the time, I ended up getting into the class.
You did?
Yes. Sometimes the professor would just let me in, seeing how serious I was to take the class. But usually one or two of the students would drop the class in the first week, and there I'd be to take their place.
Well, it sounds like a pretty good strategy.
It was for me. I found that just being there and speaking to the professor directly and showing an interest often got me into the class.
Okay, I guess it's worth a try.
Number 23. What is the man's problem? Number 24. How did the woman handle this problem in the past? Number 25. What can we infer about the woman? Number 26. What will the man probably do? Questions 27 to 29. Listen to a discussion in a sociology class. The professor is reviewing basic concepts in the field of sociology. This morning, let's begin by reviewing what we discussed on Friday. Does anyone remember how we define sociology?
It's the study of human society and social behavior, isn't it?
That's right. The way people behave is largely shaped by the groups they belong to and by the social interaction that takes place within these groups.
So you mean that I would behave differently if I were born in a different time and place, right?
Yes, according to sociologists. If you had been born in another country or another time in history, your personality, your opinions on life, and your social experiences would be quite different. This fact seems obvious enough, but it is easily overlooked. The way we were raised greatly affects the person we will become. Sociologists are mainly interested in social interaction, the ways in which people act toward, respond to, and influence one another. All types of social behavior, from greetings to religious practices to family roles, are ultimately the products of social groups. Number 27. According to the first student's comment, what is the definition of sociology? Number 28. According to the discussion, what is the main focus of sociology? Number 29. Which of the following would be of most interest to sociologists? Questions 30 to 32. Listen to a conversation between two people about registering for courses.
Excuse me.
Yes, can I help you?
Yes, I would like to take an accounting course in September, and I need some information.
Sure. Courses start on September 20th and finish right after Thanksgiving on November 30th. The introduction to accounting class meets every Monday from 6 to 10 p.m. The intermediate accounting class meets every Wednesday from 6 to 10 p.m. And the advanced accounting class meets every Thursday from 6 to 10 p.m. Registration is 1 week before classes begin, so that's September 13th.
So the classes only meet one night a week and registration is on September 13th?
Yes, that's correct.
And how much is the tuition for one course?
It's $550 per course. Are you interested in our certificate program in accounting?
Maybe. Can you tell me something about it?
Well, the coursework consists of the three classes I mentioned before. When you complete the program, you will be awarded a certificate. This program introduces the important theories and practices of accounting and is especially good for business owners, bookkeepers, or others who want to increase their basic knowledge of accounting. Would you like a brochure and an application explaining the program in more detail?
Yes, that would be great. Thank you so much. You've been very helpful.
You're welcome.
Number 30. What does the man want to do? Number 31. How many days a week does each class meet? Number 32. What will the man probably do next? Questions 33 to 36. Listen to a lecture on the history and development of written communication. The professor is giving an overview of the types of writing systems that have been used over time.
Good morning, everyone. As you will notice, I've written this week's topic on the blackboard. It says, The History and Development of Written Communication. But I didn't need to read it to you in order to communicate what our topic would be. Why not? Because the letters, or we could call them symbols, that I've used are also a form of communication. They convey information and meaning to you nonverbally. When we think of written communication, we naturally envision complex systems such as our alphabet, in which individual letters represent sounds. Or you might think of a character system like Chinese, in which characters represent syllables, words, or ideas. But long before the development of these complex systems, people were communicating via written forms. From prehistoric times, people began using pictures, symbols, and signs to record events, keep accounts, and convey information. Ancient rock drawings, paintings, and carvings found all over the world are an example of very early forms of written communication. The general term for rock drawings and paintings is pictograph, while the term petroglyphs refers specifically to rock carvings. The use of pictures to convey ideas was, and still is, a very effective form of communication, which we continue to use liberally in our modern societies. For example, if you see a red circle with a red diagonal line across it, you will recognize this to mean that something is prohibited or forbidden. If there is a picture of a burning cigarette inside the circle, you understand the meaning immediately. Smoking is prohibited here. Pictures are a very effective and universal form of communication. However, they are limited in their ability to express complex ideas. Even thousands of years ago, people realized this. The Sumerians devised a fairly refined picture writing system about 5,000 years ago that we call logographs. In this system, pictures represented individual words in the language. Thus, each picture, or logograph, corresponded to a key word in a sentence. But this system proved limited because it didn't allow for the expression of abstract ideas or the use of words that could not be represented by a picture, such as proper names.
To overcome this limitation, a more complex phonetic-based system eventually developed. In phonetic-based writing systems, pictures could still be used to represent objects, but they could also be used to represent similar-sounding words that could not be easily drawn. For example, if we used this type of phonetic-based system in English, we would represent the word belief with a picture of a bee followed by a picture of a leaf. This form of writing is often called a word-syllabic system because objects, words, and syllables could be represented by pictures or symbols. Cuneiform, with its wedge-like symbols and hieroglyphics with its pictures, are both examples of early word-syllabic writing systems. Even more complex writing forms combine both the syllabic and pictographic systems. Chinese, developed over 4,000 years ago, with as many as 50,000 characters, is an example of this blended system. Ultimately, alphabets like the one we use today came into use. Our modern alphabet is a descendant of the Roman alphabet, which was developed about 2,000 years ago. Today, most languages of the world use an alphabetic form of writing in which one symbol or letter represents one or more sounds. Now let me stop for a minute so I can answer any questions you have. And then we're going to watch a video which is entitled, From Pictograph to Paragraph, The History of Writing.
Number 33. What is the main purpose of the professor's lecture? Number 34. What does the professor say about the use of pictures and symbols to convey information? Number 35. According to the professor, what was one limitation of the logograph system of writing developed by the Sumerians? Number 36. According to the professor, how are cuneiform and hieroglyphics similar? Questions 37 to 41. Listen to part of a discussion in an archaeology class. The professor has invited a guest speaker to come in. Okay, everyone, if you'll have a seat now, we'll get started. I'd like to begin by introducing Dr. Marilyn Clearwater, head archaeologist for the Native Lands Recovery Project. She'll be telling you about one of the archaeological projects that you can get involved in to meet your field study requirements for our class. Tomorrow, we'll have Ben Allen, president of the State Historical Society, here to tell you about another project. Then you'll need to decide which one you want to volunteer for. But now, Dr. Clearwater, thank you for coming today.
It's my pleasure. Well, good afternoon, everyone. As your professor may have told you, we've just begun the very time-consuming job of surveying and mapping the entire Yolo River archaeological site. This is the first stage of the project. The work requires a number of detail-oriented individuals, and it involves walking very slowly over the entire site and recording on a grid any surface features or evidence you see that might indicate early human activity. For this phase, we need 20 volunteers for approximately 3 weeks.
Dr. Clearwater, how will we know what to look for?
We'll train you. We'll show you what to look for, how to look, how to record your observations on a grid, and even how to walk when you're doing the survey.
What if we find something like an arrowhead or a piece of pottery? Should we just leave it there?
Well, first of all, I don't expect that you'll find anything of that sort lying on the surface at this particular site. But if you should see any possible evidence of early human habitation, such as fire-charred seeds or pieces of shellfish, you must not remove them or disturb them in any way. Just leave them as they are. During the survey and mapping phase of the project, you'll only note their location on the grid.
It sounds interesting, but kind of tedious.
No question about it. It's tedious work and requires your undivided concentration. Remember, much of archaeological work is not the high-adventure Indiana Jones experience that you've seen in Hollywood films. It's often slow and exacting and involves a great deal of record keeping. But it's fascinating work and gives you a unique opportunity to peer into the past.
Where can we learn more about the Yolo River area and the people who used to live there?
I've brought with me a fact sheet about the history of the area and information about the recovery project. Help yourself to these, and if you're interested in volunteering for this project, sign up with your professor by the end of the week. Then I'll contact you to set up your work schedule. Any further questions?
Number 37. What is the main purpose of this talk? Number 38. What will the students do if they join the Yolo River Project? Number 39. Why are the students planning to do field work? Number 40. Based on information from the talk, what can be implied about the early inhabitants of the Yolo River area? Number 41. How might students learn more about the Yolo River archaeological site? Questions 42 to 46. Listen to a presentation given to students in a teacher education program.
Good afternoon, and congratulations to all of you for successful completion of the first phase of the teacher education program. I'm Deanna Cantor, the Director of Student Teaching, and I'm here to discuss the second phase of the program and explain the academic requirements that you must fulfill before applying for your student teaching position. Overall, you'll need to complete 40 units, 10 of which can be elective courses. The required courses are as follows: Teaching Methodology 1 and 2, Classroom Management, Research Methods for Educators, Computers in the Classroom, and Materials Development. The two methodology courses include instruction on teaching reading, writing, and mathematics, as well as general pedagogy. Regarding your elective courses, you may choose them from any discipline that interests you, but you must have your elective choices approved by your advisor. In addition to the course requirements, you'll need to continue with your current observations in the public schools. But you should reduce your observation hours from 6 hours per week to 4 hours per week because your course load will now be heavier. As you approach completion of the second phase of the program, your advisor and I will work with you to set up a student teaching assignment with a mentor teacher in a public school classroom. In some cases, it will be possible to do your student teaching in the same classroom where you are now observing. That's always nice because you already know the teacher and the children, so it's a little easier to adjust to the stress and responsibility of actually teaching for the first time. But that will come later when you finish the coursework in Phase 2. Now, let me stop here for a minute to answer any questions you might have.
Number 42. What is the purpose of the speaker's talk? Number 43. What courses can they choose for their two elective courses? Number 44. Based on the talk, what can we infer about the required courses for Phase 2 of the teacher education program? Number 45. Based on the talk, what can we assume about the students? Number 46. Why are students advised to reduce their observation hours in the public schools? Questions 47 to 50. Listen to a discussion in an American history course. The professor has been talking about indigenous people of North America. We've been talking about how environment shaped and dictated the lifestyles of indigenous peoples of North America. Now, with this in mind, we're going to look at a specific example, the California Indians, and discuss how environment and lifestyle led to the development of a rich tradition of basket making. And we should note that although there were as many as 80 distinctly different language groups and thousands of separate tribal units in what is now California, all of these groups used baskets and other plant products extensively. In fact, some of the finest baskets ever produced were made by California Indians.
Professor, I've heard that California Indians never developed pottery. Is that true?
No, not entirely. Some tribes did use pottery along with baskets, but others, such as the Central California Indians, developed no pottery at all. They used only baskets for both functional and ceremonial purposes. They had baskets of every size and shape for carrying, storing, and winnowing seeds. They had cone-shaped woven fish traps. They had funnel-shaped baskets with no bottoms for holding acorns or seeds as they pounded them on rocks. They had tightly woven baskets for carrying water, and even baskets for cooking.
How could they cook in a basket? Wouldn't the basket burn?
You would think so, but they had an ingenious technique. To cook, they would drop hot rocks into a basket filled with soup or porridge. The rocks heated the food, but to prevent burning the basket, they had to stir the rocks constantly. It was a very effective method. Now, in addition to baskets for food gathering and preparation, they made basket hats, baby carriers, mats, and housing materials. They even had canoes made entirely of reeds that were virtually unsinkable. Baskets for ceremonial use were often beautifully decorated with soft feathers and shell beads. Although men occasionally made baskets and nets for fishing, women did most of the basket making, and many women knew 15 to 20 different styles. Okay, so why would such an elaborate basketry culture develop among the California Indians? What features of their environment and lifestyle contributed to this?
Well, I guess that in California they had a lot of plant materials handy all year round for making baskets. Is that right?
Yes, absolutely. That's one factor. We're talking about a region with abundant natural resources. Basket-making materials, such as reeds, tools, and willow, were plentiful and easily harvested. In addition, there were many rivers and streams, and a long coastline rich in sea life, birds, and coastal vegetation. So procuring food did not require elaborate methods or technology. Baskets and woven items served the purpose well. The ease with which food could be procured, plus a temperate climate in much of the region, meant that people could spend more time on a skill, such as basket making. So, we can see how environmental conditions and the necessities of their daily lives played a major role in the development of their sophisticated basketry tradition. Now let's look at another example. Number 47. What is the main focus of this lecture? Number 48. Why does the professor use the example of the California Indians? Number 49. What is true about the California Indians? Number 50. According to the talk, why did California Indians make boats out of reeds? This is the end of the listening comprehension section for Test 1. Turn off the recording and continue with Section 2, Structure and Written Expression.